determined to assert American military power. Reagan called for the largest and the most expensive peacetime military buildup in American history, along with accelerating development of existing weapon systems. Reagan revived programs canceled by Jimmy Carter. In 1985, the Pentagon was spending more than $28 million every hour, 7 days a week. The defense budget surged from $157 billion in 1981 to $273 billion in 1986. Reagan declared that the United States stood ready to support anti-communist regimes anywhere in the world, in the Middle East, the Philippines, Chile, South Korea, South Africa, and Angola. Reagan supported repressive governments who committed flagrant human rights abuses. This contradiction in American foreign policy was especially obvious with Reagan's support of apartheid in South Africa. Apartheid is a system of legal segregation where blacks in South Africa are forced into living in makeshift walled-in shanty towns. Their communities are surrounded by walls they cannot leave without government permission. Black people in South Africa were denied the most basic of human dignities, and South Africa stood at the brink of civil war. Jimmy Carter protested the whites-only regime in South Africa, but Reagan preferred a policy of constructive engagement. Reagan resisted all calls by liberals and human rights groups to coerce South Africa into dismantling apartheid. South Africa, instead, was supposed to be a bulwark against communism. In 1986, Congress demanded that the president apply sanctions to South Africa, but Reagan blocked any attempts to apply any pressure to the apartheid regime. Reagan entered office with a distaste for arms control. He believed that the United States had weakened its military arsenal during arms reductions talks in the 1970s, and this gave the Soviets the upper hand. Reagan took a hard line in his negotiation with the Soviets. One example of Reagan's shrewd negotiation was during the Intermediate Nuclear Forces, the INF talks, in 1981. The INF negotiations were initiated by Jimmy Carter with the goal of addressing the nuclear balance of power in Europe. The Soviet Union would have to agree to dismantle its 600 intermediate-range missiles that it contained in Europe and Asia. In exchange, the United States would agree only not to deploy any new medium-range missiles. On September 1, 1983, the Soviet jet shot down a Korean Airlines passenger plane after it strayed into Soviet airspace during a flight from South Korea to Alaska. All 269 passengers on board perished. American intelligence suggested that the tragedy was the result of confusion, but also incompetence among Soviet military officials who erroneously believed that the civilian airliner was a spy plane. A few weeks later, September 16, 1983, the destruction of Korean Airlines Flight 7 caused Ronald Reagan to make GPS available to the public. The U.S. military had global GPS systems, but it was classified technology only for government use. They concluded that if the Korean Airlines pilots had access to GPS, they would have been able to avoid entering Soviet airspace. When Reagan made GPS data available to the public, he slightly scrambled its accuracy for all users except for the U.S. military. Because the American government ultimately paid for and is maintaining this global satellite system that everyone in the world can use, it only makes sense that the American government wanted to have a higher quality and more accurate readings to have an edge over rivals. President Bill Clinton did away with this scrambling in the system in 2000 after it became an outdated policy. For national security purposes, Russia maintains its own satellite GPS network, known as GLONASS, and it is also available for public use. The GLONASS system is actually typically more accurate in pinpointing GPS locations in the global north and in the Arctic. It's very useful in Russia and Canada. Galileo is another GPS satellite service that is run by the European Union. After the Korean Airlines accident, the Reagan administration called out the Soviets as the evil empire. The Soviet Union feared the United States was preparing for war. Soviet diplomats walked out of the IMF talks, leaving the two superpowers without any ongoing negotiations for the first time in 14 years. The United States deployed new missiles in West Germany, Great Britain, and Italy. The USSR moved new rockets into Czechoslovakia and East Germany. The American public was divided on Reagan's response to the Soviet threat and ramping up military spending. The threat of nuclear annihilation frightened Americans. A wide variety of academic and religious leaders within Reagan's coalition questioned the wisdom of his policies. American Catholic bishops prepared a pastoral letter delivered to Reagan personally, opposing nuclear war on moral and theological grounds. Reagan countered, trying to defuse calls for arms limitations by instead proposing to build a space-based anti-ballistic missile defense shield. After all, why bother with arms reduction if we can just use satellites to blast Soviet missiles out of the sky? In March of 1983, in a nationally televised speech, Reagan announced his defensive shield, the Strategic Defense Initiative, the SDI. Even though it had never been previously mentioned or discussed by the National Security Council or the Pentagon, it was nicknamed the Star Wars Plan. Reagan allocated $17 billion towards the development of this new defense system between 1983 and 1989. In 1987, 4 years into development, the scientific community concluded the technology to make this possible would not exist for decades. It is not possible to make this system as envisioned. Reagan insisted on maintaining funding for the SDI. Bill Clinton formally ended the program in 1993. Although Reagan's efforts to develop the system did not fully materialize, research and development for the project contributed to a number of advances in American anti-ballistic systems. And so that's why they maintained the program even after they concluded it was scientifically impossible. But by 1985, tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union began to cool off. Mikhail Gorbachev came into power in the Soviet Union. Gorbachev sought to renew detente with the United States as the Soviet economy was in very bad shape. He sought to reform the Soviet Union. Gorbachev is known for his policies of perestroika and glasnost. Perestroika means restructuring. Gorbachev sought to stimulate the Russian economy by relaxing government control of the economy. Glasnost means openness. The goal of Gorbachev's foreign policy is he would negotiate with the United States to achieve his goals diplomatically. Gorbachev wanted to avoid an expensive arms race, so he declared a moratorium on deployment of medium-range missiles in Europe, and he asked that the United States do the same. He diverted military spending to pay for programs that would benefit the Russian people, and he called for cooperation between the communist and capitalist worlds to avoid nuclear and ecological disaster. For the rest of his time in power, Gorbachev made news every few months with another bold reform targeted at either perestroika, glasnost, or some form of arms control, and he made it very clear that he wanted to end the war in Afghanistan. In a move that surprised liberals and angered Republicans. Ronald Reagan welcomed Gorbachev, and Reagan now supported arms reduction talks with the Soviet Union. In 1986, Reagan and Gorbachev met at Reykjavik, Iceland, and agreed on a first step towards cutting nuclear forces in half. And in 1987, they agreed to the INF Treaty, for the first time called for the destruction of existing missiles in the stockpile, and allowed for on-site inspection of their facilities to verify compliance with the treaty. When a reporter asked Reagan in 1987 if he still thought the Soviet Union was an evil empire, Reagan responded, "No, I was talking about another time, another era."